I will send my messenger, who will prepare the way before me. Then suddenly the Lord you are seeking will come to his temple. The messenger of the covenant whom you desire will come, says the Lord Almighty.
For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace.
What do you mean you can't speak? You put that down and talk to me, Zachariah. You went to the temple to burn incense, and now you can't speak. Oh, because you doubted. What does that even mean? You doubted what an angel told you. Oh, now it's all making sense. Are you feeling all right, huh? Maybe you should sit down. Oh, I should sit down. Listen, whatever game you're playing, I really wanted to stop, Zachariah. It isn't funny. This isn't funny, Zachariah. An angel told you this. The angel said that our prayers have been heard. That you, my love, will bear a son. That we will be filled with joy and gladness, and that many will rejoice at his birth. He will be like Elijah. He will prepare our people for the Lord. I'm too old to be a mother. And you! You can't even speak! Oh, you can't even speak until he's born! Oh, that might not be the worst thing. I can't wait to tell my cousin Mary. We will call him Zachariah, yes?
Good evening and welcome to our Christmas Eve service. We welcome you to enter in. We've entered in through the church, through the stable at the beginning of our dear Saviour's birth. We invite you to enter in to participate in the service tonight as well. The parts that are read by the narrators and by our actors all come from the Bible and come from the readings leading up to Jesus' birth. We encourage you to participate when you're called upon. There are certain rows that have got tinsel and some costumes and things, and at different points, Lester, as our narrator, will give you instructions, or Lisa, as our assistant director, will help you out there as well. But tonight is all about entering into Christ's life, into his journey, and learning and reminding us once again about the journey that Jesus took for us, to save us. So we ask you to enter into the church. We ask you to enter again into a relationship with Christ. And we invite you to open your hearts to allow the Holy Spirit and Jesus to enter into your lives once again. And we're going to begin now with our choir joining us for our first set of songs. So the choir, come on out.
In the sixth month of Elizabeth's pregnancy, God sent the angel Gabriel to Nazareth, a town in Galilee, to a virgin pledged to be married to a man named Joseph, a descendant of David. The virgin's name was Mary. The angel went to her and said,
"Baby boy, walk on water. Mary, did you know that your baby boy would save our sons and daughters? Did you know that your baby boy has come to make you new? This child that you delivered will soon
greetings, you who are highly favored. The Lord is with you."
Mary was greatly troubled at his words and wondered what kind of greeting this might be, but But the angel said to her,
Mary, did you know that your baby boy will give sight to a blind man? Mary, did you know that your baby boy would calm the storm with his hand? Did you know that your baby boy has walked where angels trod? When you kiss your little baby, you've kissed the face of God. Oh, Mary, did you know?
Do not be afraid, Mary. You have found favor with God. You will conceive and give birth to a son, and you are to call him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over Jacob's descendants forever. His kingdom will never end.
How can this be, since I am a virgin?
Mary, did you know? The blind will see, the deaf will hear, the dead will live again. The lame will leap, the dumb will speak, the praises of the Lamb.
The angel answered,
The Holy Spirit will come on you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So, the Holy One to be born will be called the Son of God. Even Elizabeth, your relative, is going to have a child in her old age. And she, who is said to be unable to conceive, is in her sixth month. For no word from God will ever fail.
I am the Lord's servant. May your word to me be fulfilled.
Then the angel left her.
Mary, did you know that your baby boy is Lord of all creation? Mary, did you know that your baby boy will one day rule the nations? Did you know that your baby boy is heaven's perfect lamb? And the sleeping child you're holding is a great I am. Mary, did you
Sweetie, are you listening?
Mary, I've said it once, so I'll say it again. I can do two things.
Two things at once, yes, I know. But we really need to talk. And Joseph?
Yeah?
I need you to listen.
I am listening so hard right now. You can't even imagine how much I'm concentrating on you and... words.
I'm overwhelmed by your concentration. Can you just stop for a second, please?
Mary, I would love to stop for a second, but I can't.
Why not?
We're gonna be married soon, and I just want everything to be perfect.
Joseph, I love your heart. I really do, but you know, not everything has to be perfect, and that's okay, because we don't know what life is gonna throw at us, you know?
Right, but I still want a house worthy of you, and to do that, I've got to work, because a man's...
Man has got to have a plan.
Have I mentioned that before?
A time or two.
Mary, I have so many plans for us. This table, this is where we're going to have our meals together, and I've made it big enough for to seat some little ones. For down the road, of course.
About that.
Where did I put that chisel?
Joseph, I need to tell you something. Something... something unbelievable.
Did I put it in that shelf?
I was visited by... by an angel.
Yeah?
And he told me that I was highly favored.
Mm-hmm.
And it all felt... it felt like a dream until he told me something. And the instant he said it, I knew that it was true.
I just used it. I just had it.
Joseph, are you listening to me?
Yeah, that sounds really great.
Joseph.
Got it.
I'm pregnant.
All of you are going to have a wonderful night tonight. Tonight's such a blessing to have so many of you here and hearing the message of Christmas all over again. During our next songs, we'll be offering, taking up offering for any of you who would like to provide that as well. So our next songs are going to be Hark the Heralds and Angels We Have Heard on High.
Mountains in reply, echo.
Okay, so like Joe said, tonight is about getting you guys involved. Now's your time to shine. If you've got a bit of instructions in front of you, this is your time to show us what you've got. In those days, Caesar Augustus issued a decree that a census should be taken of the entire Roman world. This was the first census that took place while Quirinius was governor of Syria. And there was great movement among the people travelling to their hometown. And there was great movement among the people travelling to their hometown. And there was great movement among the people travelling to their town. And there was great movement among the people travelling to their hometown. So if you've got the tinsel, you find your town you need to go to. And everyone went to their own town to register. So Joseph also went up from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to Bethlehem, the town of David, because he belonged to the house and line of David. Very good.
All booked up, sorry.
We don't need much.
What part of I'm all booked up did you not understand? I have no room for you in my inn.
Please. We've been walking for days.
Do you think you are the first person to pound on my door at this hour of the night looking for a room?
There has to be something. A closet, perhaps.
You can keep asking the same question. I'm going to give you the same answer.
What are you doing up? You need to rest now. We won't be any trouble. And I'll pay you whatever you want. Please.
I'm sorry. No vacancies.
God will provide.
Hey. Give me a minute.
Joseph went to Bethlehem to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for the baby to be born. There was no guest room available for them. She gave birth to her firstborn, a son. She wrapped him in cloths and placed him in a manger.
Yes, we had to wait for the main thing, didn't we? So you may think you have no purpose in God's economy, but even a cushion has a place in the worship of our Lord. We're invited to enter in. I don't know where you're from or where you're going, but and because the lights are shining in my eyes, I can't really tell who you are from here, but I just know there's a crowd of people there. And among us, some of us come because we're invited, some of us come because it's the thing to do, some of us come because we want to enjoy that Christmas feeling. You know, there's nothing like a Christmas Eve service just to get us in the right frame of mind, the mood of Christmas, that Christmas feeling. It's just fantastic. I love those things. You know, it starts with the carols evenings. We had ours in Gatton about a month ago, and it starts that Christmas feeling, doesn't it? The end of year parties, the things, but when the carol starts, that's Christmas for me. I don't know what it is for you. There's some of those things that just gets you into that Christmas spirit. And I pray that you're there this evening. Because, let's face it, Christmas is nearly over. If you're not there now, you know, who knows where you're going to be. But here we are, celebrating Christmas. We celebrate by having these scripts read. We know the story, don't we? There's no surprises here this evening. Yes, the surprises may be, I mean, I'm surprised every year with this place because this church seems to crank up something new every year. And, you know, now we had an angel up there and I hope you didn't miss it. But but we go through that script, maybe in different ways. We go through that script. We recite the story, which we all know. And then we go home. Possibly unwrap your presents. I just want to philosophize for a moment about the scripting of Christmas. A script is set, isn't it? You know what's written in a script, and you read through the script, and then you're finished. And what we're doing is speaking of a historical event, something that happened all of those years ago. And so we recite that story, we go through the story from start to finish, all of the points of the story, we go through it, and then the story is done. Now that's not quite Christmas, because Christmas isn't scripted. You see, it would be if Jesus was only a historical figure that we talked about it. It would be if Christmas was a set of statements or beliefs which we had to come to understand, and then it's finished. Christmas isn't finished. Christmas is a moving event. Christmas is a living event because Jesus is still alive. Jesus is still part of this world. Jesus is still with us. And for the filling in of that story, you'll have to come at Easter and we'll talk more about that. But for now, this Christmas event, we come here, we partake of the Christmas story, but then Christmas follows you home. Christmas remains a part of your life because Jesus wants to remain a part of your life. To the extent that we allow him. You see, the story of Christmas can finish here for you. Can finish with the last joy to the world or whatever we're singing at the end. Can finish as the candles go out. Can finish as we pack away the tree. Christmas can finish for you. Or it can continue because God is still active in this world and Jesus knocks on our door and calls us to let him in. Jesus knocks on our heart and say, will you let me in? Will you let me become a part of your life? Will you let Christmas continue throughout the year, throughout your life? Or does it end here? And so he calls us to open up, let him in, and continue Christmas some more. I'll tell you a little story. Seeing we're into stories and scripts and that kind of thing, I'll tell you a little story. There was a father took his son to the show. Now, I don't know, when I was a kid, we had the show. Do you have an agricultural show here in the Lockyer? Help me a bit here. Yes, right. So you got a. Do you have cows that go around? You know, people show their stuff, bales of hay, you know, the wheat. Yep. Oh, we got lots of nods. Yes, you do all that. Excellent. So same as when I was a kid, we had the Loxton Horticultural Society annual show. Which my dad was on the committee, of course, because he was on all the committees. But now he's a wine judge, and they give him all the leftover wine. So that's a little bit of a bonus there. But anyway, you get the agricultural show. Now, I don't know about your dad or your parents when you went to the show, but what my dad would do, we'd go and park somewhere. Like, you drive in, you get a good spot to park, and he always seemed to park in the sun because he would calculate where the sun was going to be when we finished, and that's so when the if the shade was there, he would park in the spot where the shade was going to be, not where the shade was now. So we used to always sling off at him that he'd always go and park in the hottest place, you know. Anyway, that's just my dad. I don't know if your dad did that too, but. So anyway, story, just setting the scene here. Father took his little boy to the show. And little boy got in the car, dad's brand new car. And they were going to have a great day together. Father drove off, taking the boy to the show. It was a hot day, extra hot, so they called in on the way to get an ice cream. They got an ice cream each. Father gives the son an ice cream, gets his ice cream, and off they go. And then they pull in to, of course, a nice hot car park where the shade is going to be, but isn't now. The dad gets out of the car to, you know, arrange things, get the bag and that, and then get the kid out of the car. But there's a little breeze and pushes the door shut. Bumping the father's hand at the same time, and the slamming of the door made the little boy look, and he dropped his ice cream on the seat of the brand new car. I can see some dads, you know, hurting with me right now. So now, ice cream on the seat of the brand new car. The father now, who's as the door was shutting, it bumped his hand too, and he dropped his ice cream on the dirt. And as he did, as he saw that, he let a groan of anguish out. The little boy heard his father roar and thought that he'd seen the ice cream on the seat. And so in fear, the little boy reached over and pushed down the door lock. The father heard the lock, looked up, and saw his son now trapped in a car in the sun. "Open the door," he calls. "No," says the son, and looks away, because the son thinks the father wants to punish him for dropping ice cream on the seat of the new car. The keys are still in the ignition. The father begins to get concerned. Seconds seem like hours as he feels the heat of the day bursting down on the car, and he knows that there's not long that he has to get this kid out of the car. So he says, "Open the door." And the little boy doesn't even look at his father. If he did, he would have seen the anguish on his father's face. "Open the door, please open the door," he says, and something in the pleading gets through to the little kid, who turns and in fear says, "Don't smack me." The father says, "Smack you? I don't want to smack you, I want to save you. I want to get you out of that hot car and give you a drink." Oh, I better finish the story. It all ends up happily because the son reaches over, pulls up the doorknob, and the father hugs the son, gets him out of there, and gets him a brand new ice cream and the keys. Little boy was in a pickle, wasn't he? We're in that same pickle, really. We've got ourselves in a terrible situation, and some of us don't even know it. We think God is angry with us, but all he wants to do is save us, and all we need to do is open the door and let him in. Let that be Christmas for you. Don't let Christmas go by without letting God into your life, not just to interest you, not just to answer a few questions, but to save you, because that's what he wants to do. May this Christmas be one for you where you truly discover the Jesus who loves you, the Jesus who wants to come with you, the Jesus who would save you, because that's why he came. Let this be Christmas for you. Amen. Some of you may want to follow through with some questions that may have been raised this evening. And that's what I want to do, is to, in future, offer a time of discovery. And so that's what I want to do on the 9th of January, which is a Sunday, 7 p.m. You've got to, you know, guess at a time which would be suitable. But at this time, 9th of January, 7 p.m, I want to deal with the question, who is Jesus? So if you'd like to explore further, who is Jesus? Who is Jesus for you? What does he mean for me? Is he a real person on this world? Whatever. If you want to explore those questions, then please join me here 7 p.m. on the 9th of January. Thanks, Lester.
And there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them,
"Do not be afraid. I bring you good news that will cause great joy for all the people. Today, in the town of David, a Saviour has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign to you, and you will find a baby wrapped in clothes and lying in a manger."
Suddenly, a great company of the heavenly host appeared with the angel, praising God and saying,
"Ready, angels? Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace to those on whom his favor rests."
When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another,
"Let's go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about."
Wait. Someone has to watch the sheep.
What are you talking about?
Someone has to watch the sheep. They're sheep, okay? They eat, they poop, they sleep. They'll be fine, let's go.
That is the same thing that you said when you wanted to go see the Mutton and Sons concert, and we saw it, and we lost half our flock.
Sam! Angels, they just popped out of the sky, and instead of sprinting to Bethlehem, you're all like, "No, we gotta take care of the sheep. What about their abandonment issues?"
Hey guys, I'm gonna race you, okay? Last one there is the stinky loincloth. Let's go!
Look, okay? The angels are there, okay? That's what they do. That's why we call them guarding angels.
No, it's guardian angels, guardian.
Tomato, who cares? Why are we still standing here?
Someone needs to watch the sheep. You know it, I know it, and the sheep know it.
Sheep don't feel.
You can't prove that. Fine, there's only one way to solve this. Rock, parchment, shears. Loser stays with the sheep.
Rock, parchment, shears, shoot! Rock, parchment, shears, shoot! Rock, parchment, shears, shoot! Ah!
Today, in the town of David, a Savior will be born unto you.
Right.
Why did the angel say that? Why did the angel tell a bunch of lowly shepherds about the coming of the Messiah? I mean, why us?
I don't know why us, but they did. So maybe this Messiah didn't just come for people that matter. Maybe he came for people like us. Which is all the more reason why we need to go.
I know. And I want to. It's just a lot to take in. It's been a crazy night.
Hey, did you see how fast I was running? Over there, I was like a lightning bolt. But, no, you guys are never gonna believe this. I forgot my good cloak. Can you imagine me meeting the Messiah without my good cloak? That would be ridiculous. I can't even. I'll see you.
Let me bottom line this for you. I, for one, cannot not go see this Messiah, okay? So if what you're saying is that I, instead of seeing the man who's gonna change everything, have to stay here and sheep sit, well, that just won't work for me.
You're right.
But before we go, I'm not trying to nitpick, but you said cannot not, and that's a double negative. It is. Promise me when we go meet the Messiah, you cannot not talk like that. Promise me you won't talk like that to the Messiah. Promise me. He's a baby. He's in swaddling clothes. I don't think he's gonna care how we del-
Okay, fine. Me talk pretty. Let's go.
Wait. I think I just solved our problem.
What are you guys still doing here? What are you waiting for? It's the King of Kings, okay? So less standy, more runny.
Frank, take a knee.
Okay.
We were playing rock, parchment, cheers.
Oh, yeah?
You lost.
Oh.
So the shepherds hurried off and found Mary and Joseph and the baby, who was lying in the manger. When they had seen him, they spread the word concerning what had been told them about this child, and all who had heard it were amazed at what the shepherds said to them. Would you all join us in singing Away in a Manger? Cool. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all things they had heard and seen, which were just as they had been told. Would you all join us in singing The Little Drummer Boy?
Told me, pa-ra-pa-pam-pam.
Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you that we can come and celebrate this wonderful time of year again. We thank you that that you are with us, that you've promised to be with us, and you've proven that by sending Jesus humbly in a manger, but sending him into our world. And so we can be assured of his presence with us. We pray, Lord, that we could take his presence into every corner of our lives. Lord, come with us as we go from this place. Come with us into our confusion and shine a light. Come with us into our sickness and bring healing. Come with us into our troubles and worries and bring your comfort. Lord, we pray for the leaders of our community, that they would lead wisely, that they would lead well, humbly, and with justice. We pray that you be with the nations of the earth and bring peace and harmony. We pray that you would be with those who suffer because of the turmoil we face at the moment in these troubled times. And we pray that you would bring your healing and hope into every situation. Lord, we pray that you would release us from the ravages that a pandemic can bring. And Father, we pray that as we leave this place, as we've celebrated here this evening, this wonderful story of Christmas, as we go to our homes and our dinners, our presents and our celebrations, our holidays, our families, we pray that you go with us. And when you knock, Lord, give us the grace to open the door. We pray these things in the name of Jesus, our Lord. Amen. May the blessing of Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit go with you now and always. Amen.
Rob forgot to do this, but we'd like to invite all the children up the front and any cast members that were able to come up the front and sing with us Silent Night.
The word's probably out now that I have no idea what I'm doing, so I've been sprung. Now there's rumours of something for the kids. What could that be? What do you think it might be? Do I know? My own. A candle. Yes, it's probably a candle. I knew there was something for the kids, but it's probably a candle.
Brussels sprouts,
yeah. So we'll be handing out Brussels sprouts for all of the children very shortly. But first, before we do that, I just wanted to commend everybody involved in setting up. I mean, have a look around you. Just take a look at my view here. If you can just look at the decoration of the balcony there is just fantastic. And as we look around, you know, I mean, the way the cross has been decorated is just fantastic. So I want to commend all the people and Lester and his team for pulling this together. And of course, all the people who did things. I mean, it was fantastic just to walk in through the manger this evening, through the stable scene. As we came in this evening. So just a fantastic Christmas thing. And of course, all you people who came along this evening just makes it a wonderful Christmas celebration. So I just want to inject a word of thank you for people there. I just want to remind you of my invitation for Sunday the 9th at 7 p.m. If you've got any questions regarding the, from time to time the question comes up about Jesus being a historical person or you know, who is Jesus in this world today? You know, does he still have the same impact as he did 2,000 years ago? If you've got any questions, whether they be historical, literal, about the Bible, or just about faith and about where you fit in all this, then come along. That's what those evenings are for. Bring a friend and we'll talk. And we'll explore some things. So that's enough from me, because the kids are probably wondering where their Brussels sprouts are.
Joe, did you want to explain what's happening?
Oh, do I need to? Okay. So we've got some people over here with boxes of gifts for you, but we've also got these ones here. I don't know if Mary's hanging around that she wants to help hand them out. But we've got a little gift for each of the kids here. So as you walk out, if you collect a gift from Mary or my
So Mary or Joseph? Yep, go to Mary, go to Joseph, and then to Josephine.
So thank you very much for everybody for joining us tonight. As you are leaving, we're going to sing you one last song.